And I close my eyes and I'm floating along. And I close my eyes and I'm running along. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I welcome you to another episode of our series, Sirat al-Rasul, Lessons and Morals. I am your host, Yasir Qadhi. In our previous episode, we had discussed the early stages of the da'wah and the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then made a public announcement to all of the people of Mecca and he began preaching openly and publicly. And the way that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would do this was that he would go to the people who had come from outside of Mecca. He would stand in front of their caravans. He would go to the Hujjaj and the pilgrims and he would ask them permission to speak to them. And this is of the etiquettes of giving da'wah. You do not just barge in and start talking. Rather, he would say, do you have a few minutes? Can I speak with you about worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Can I speak with you about the religion that Allah has sent me with? And when they would give him permission, he would then tell them that only Allah is worthy of worship. They should not turn to anything else and any other being for worship. Now, what was the response? What was the initial opposition that the people of Mecca did? We need to realize that the people of Mecca, as we said, were a tribal society. They prided their culture, their civilization. They were so proud of who they were. And they rejected the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not because they didn't make sense, but because their forefathers were upon another religion. Their main excuse was, how can you come and break away from us the religion of our forefathers? Who are you to preach a different message than our forefathers' message? It wasn't that it doesn't make sense. It wasn't that we don't believe that Allah created us. No, they knew Allah created them. They knew there is one God that is worthy of worship. But it was pride of culture, pride of civilization. Who are you to come break our civilization and culture? That was their main evidence and main excuse against the teachings of Islam. So the first thing they did, they gathered together and they went to Abu Talib, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they said, you need to do something to make him stop this new message. Make him stop preaching Islam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's uncle, Abu Talib, told them, he is an adult now. I am not in charge of him. He can do as he pleases. So the first attempt failed. Then after a few weeks and months, they came to him again and they said, we demand you that you prevent your nephew from preaching. Why are they going to Abu Talib? Because Abu Talib is the chief of the Banu Hashim. He is the leader of the tribe of Banu Hashim. And the Banu Hashim, of course, is the tribe of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it is a tribal society. When you go to the chief has the power to stop you. You must obey the chief. You must listen to the chieftain of the clan. You cannot disobey him. So they go to Abu Talib. He is the leader of that sub-tribe of the Quraysh. And they say, we are not giving you any choice. If you don't stop him, then you will see what will happen next. They threatened him. You will see what will happen next. You have to stop him from preaching this message. So the Prophet ﷺ was called to Abu Talib's house. And Abu Talib had a meeting with him. And he said, oh my nephew, you know that I have nothing against you. You know that I love you. You know that I do not have any problem with you preaching this thing. But your people have come to me and they have demanded that you stop this thing. And I cannot oppose my people. These are my people. This is the Quraysh. This is my society, my city. I cannot oppose them. At this, the Prophet ﷺ stood up and he became emotional. And he said, oh my uncle, oh my uncle, oh Abu Talib, by Allah, if you were to give me the power over the sun and the moon, if you were to give the sun in my right hand and the moon in my left hand, in other words, if you were to offer me all that the world has to offer and more than that, I would never give up teaching this message. In another version of the same incident, he said, oh my uncle, do you see this sun outside? Abu Talib said, yes. He said, are you able to take a branch and light a fire from that sun? Can you take a branch and use the sun's fire to light it? Abu Talib said, no, that's not possible. He said, in the same way, it is not possible for me to stop preaching the light of Islam. I can't cover up the light of Islam. I can't put myself into darkness now that Allah has given me the light of Islam. Just like you cannot light a fire from the sun directly, I cannot extinguish the light of Islam directly. It's not something I'm possible to do. So when Abu Talib saw the enthusiasm and how strong was the resolve of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Talib told him, "Oh my nephew, do as you please. From now on, I will never stop you again. I will never come to you again about this. Face whatever happens. Whatever happens, I'm going to be with you." Despite this love and concern and care, the strange fact of the matter is that Abu Talib did not accept Islam. He remained a pagan. He remained an idol worshipper. And he died an idol worshipper. And yet, he supported the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as much as he could. And this is of the greatest wisdoms of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why so? It shows you first and foremost that no human being, even the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, has the power to guide somebody. No human being controls Jannah and Jahannam, heaven and hell. No human being can snap his fingers and say, "Be and it is." Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Rabb. Only Allah can guide. Only Allah can decide and decree. Even the beloved Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam does not have divine powers. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted his uncle to accept Islam. His uncle refused till the very end, and he died an idol worshipper. And it also shows, and this is a very beautiful wisdom, Arabia, as we said over and over again, was a tribal society. If you didn't have the backing of your tribe, you were a doomed man. If you were a stranger, you could be killed and nobody will do anything. If you're a nobody, if you're in another territory, you can be robbed, you can be pillaged, you can be plundered, and nobody can protect you. There is no law, there is no police, there is no state and government. It is the rule of the tribe. Your tribe protects you. If somebody harms you, it is the responsibility of your tribe to protect you. And the Quraysh is the elite tribe, the noble tribe. And within the Quraysh, the Banu Hashim are the elite of the elite, the cream of the crop. No tribe has more prestige and honor than the Banu Hashim amongst the Quraysh. And the Prophet ﷺ is from that tribe, a grandson of Abdul Muttalib. And this is all the will of Allah that that was his lineage. The one person who had the power to strip him of his citizenship. Tribal is like a passport. Like in our times, if you belong to a powerful country and you're in another country, you say, "Look, this is the country I belong to. Don't touch me or else my country will come after you. My services, my consular office is going to become angry at you." You have the power in this modern world to do that. In those days, the power was the tribe. You say, "I am from the Banu Hashim, the Banu Abdul Muttalib, the Quraysh," and that will get you prestige and status. The one person who has the right to pull that citizenship away was Abu Talib. Abu Talib could have said, "I reject you as being part of the Quraysh. You are no longer a part of the Banu Hashim." He had the power to do that, the right to do that. But Allah Azza wa Jal willed that Abu Talib be a supporter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also look at the irony. If Abu Talib had accepted Islam, what would have happened? His own people of the Banu Hashim would have rejected him as the chief. They would have said, "You are now a Muslim, you cannot be our leader." And so they would have rejected him and replaced him with another leader, and that leader would not have been sympathetic to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So look at the irony. By remaining in shirk and kufr, Abu Talib could remain the leader of the Quraysh, and by remaining the leader of the Quraysh, he could give the protection to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If Abu Talib had accepted Islam, he would have lost the leadership of the Quraysh and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have been left without a protector. So look at the divine plan and wisdom. Look at how Allah Azza wa Jal perfected everything. And when Abu Talib died, he died the death of a pagan, an idol worshipper. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was greatly grieved and he cried and he said, "I will ask Allah to forgive you until Allah stops me from doing so." At this, Allah revealed many verses in the Quran. He revealed in the Quran, "Innaka la tahdi man ahbabta, walakinna Allah yahdi man yasha." You, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, don't have the power to guide whom you love. You don't have that power. Rather, Allah guides whom He wants to guide. It is not in your power, Ya Rasulullah, to guide and misguide. You cannot cause people to enter Jannah or Jahannam. That is not your power. It is up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this shows us that even though the Rasul is the greatest human being and the most blessed and the most beloved, he is not God, nor is he a demigod, nor is he a semi-god. He is not divine. He is a human being, the best, but still nonetheless a human. Allah guides, Allah decrees, Allah wills, and only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is worthy of worship. We need to take a short break now. When we come back, we'll continue talking about this stage of the da'wah. Please stay with us. Welcome back. We were discussing the opposition that the early Meccan society showed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we were discussing the fact that his uncle Abu Talib refused to accept Islam until he died, and the divine wisdom behind this. The Quraysh and the pagans tried other tactics as well. Of the things that they tried was to spread false rumors about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They said many evil things about him. They accused him of diseases and madness. They accused him of being a sorcerer and magician. They accused him of plagiarizing from other sources. What is this religion? We haven't heard of it. You must have learnt it from other people. You must have learnt it from other teachers. Even though in Mecca at that time, there were no other religions. There were no pious and famous knowledgeable Christians and Jews. There were no rabbis and priests in Mecca to teach the Prophet ﷺ anything. Yet here he is giving the stories of the prophets of old, narrating to them what happened to Prophet Moses, Prophet Jesus, Prophet Ibrahim, Prophet Noah, Prophet Adam. These stories were unknown to the Arabs. Remember, the Arabs were not Christian. The Arabs were not somebody, a people that had all of this. There were, as we said, some Christians here and there, like Waraqa, but they were not preaching Christianity. They were not teaching it. They were Christians in their homes, nor was there a single church or a single synagogue in the entire city of Mecca. The entire city of Mecca was a pagan city. The fact that the Prophet ﷺ is coming and teaching this new religion, they had to somehow diminish the status of this Prophet. So what did they do? They accused him of being a crazy lunatic. You must be a madman. How can you come and say these things? They accused him, as we said, of being a magician and sorcerer. They said, you are coming forth with a speech that entices people, mesmerizes them. You must be a magician. And of course, the reason they said this was that the Quran had a semi-magical effect, if you like. It had an effect that entranced the people. When the Prophet ﷺ recited the Quran, the people just stood there listening in awe. The beauty of the Quran, the power of the Quran, and the eloquence of the Quran, it was beyond what humans knew. And of course, to this day, when anybody hears the Quran, even those who don't understand Arabic, they are awed by the beauty of its recitation. And that is a miracle that shows you the Quran is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they said, this must be a magician because you are coming forth with this new thing. And they gave other accusations as well. Another tactic that they used was that they would try to follow the Prophet ﷺ wherever he went and make sure that the people did not listen to him. So for example, Abu Lahab, his own uncle, would accompany the Prophet ﷺ when he would go to a delegation. He would go to a caravan, and when he stood up to preach, Abu Lahab would shout out from the back, "Don't listen to him. He is my nephew. He is a madman. He is a magician. He is a sorcerer. He is a person who has broken the tradition of our forefathers. Avoid him." And so he would disrupt, physically disrupt, the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, they ridiculed him in other manners as well. It is narrated once that a man came to Mecca and sold something to Abu Jahl, and Abu Jahl did not give him his money back. And so the man approached the people of Mecca, the Quraysh, and he complained and he said, "Abu Jahl has not given my money back." Abu Jahl was the worst enemy of Islam. Now realize, Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab are two separate people. Many people get confused between them. Many Muslims don't understand. Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab are two separate people. Abu Lahab is the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Jahl is another member of Quraysh, one of the nobles of Quraysh, but he is not a direct relative. Abu Jahl owed this person some money. So this person complained to the nobleman of Quraysh, and he said, "Abu Jahl has not given me my money." So as a ridicule, they said, "We will send you to somebody who can get your money from you for Abu Jahl." Go to the house of so-and-so, meaning the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, knock on the door and tell him to come with you to Abu Jahl's house to get the money. In other words, they wanted to play a practical joke, a prank, and see what would happen. So the man knocked on the door of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, the people of Quraysh have sent me to you. Of course, the man has no idea what's happening. He is completely in the dark. What is happening, Abu Jahl and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he doesn't know. And he said, they have sent me to you that you are a noble person who will get my money from Abu Jahl for me. So the Prophet ﷺ said, yes, I will get it for you. He took the man by the hand and he marched to the door of Abu Jahl and he knocked on the door and he said, oh Abu Jahl, come outside. Abu Jahl heard the voice of the Prophet ﷺ and he jumped up in fear and trepidation, jumped up trembling, and he opened the door. And there is the Prophet ﷺ with this man. The Prophet ﷺ said, Abu Jahl, give the man his money back now. Abu Jahl said, yes, immediately. He jumped and he went to his bed. He took out the coins and he gave it to the man and he shut the door. The Prophet ﷺ went back home. The man thought everything is as planned. He was very happy. He came back to the people in front of the Kaaba, the Quraysh, and he said, may Allah reward you greatly. You sent me to the right man. He got my money back. The people were shocked. How could Abu Jahl have done this? When Abu Jahl came, they said, Abu Jahl, what is the matter with you? How could you have given the money to the man? We tried to play a joke, we tried to embarrass, ridicule the Prophet ﷺ. Abu Jahl said, O people, as soon as I heard the voice of the Prophet ﷺ, a terror struck me that I cannot describe. I cannot explain to you. And I was so terrified. I was trembling with fear. So I gave the money back because of this terror and trembling. And when I opened the door and I saw the Prophet ﷺ, it was something that I cannot describe for you what I felt. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threw terror into the heart of Abu Jahl and he had to give the money back to this person. And this is a miracle that happened and they didn't even realize it. The person who took the money did not even realize it and he thought that everything was as planned. But the point what I'm trying to show you, the ridicule that they tried to do to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One other thing that they did also as an aspect of ridicule, they asked for miracles. They said, if you're a prophet, why don't you do these miracles for us? Why don't you spring forth another well instead of Zamzam? Why don't you bring for us gold and silver? Why don't you show us the angels? Why don't you resurrect the dead? Why don't you bring a book down from the sky when we're looking at it? Show us if you are a prophet or messenger. So show us what you can do. And the Prophet ﷺ would always tell them, I am but a human being. Listen to my message. Listen to what I'm saying. Listen to what I'm saying. I am a prophet of Allah. I am a human. I am not God. I cannot do these things unless Allah wills. And indeed, by the way, Allah showed them some miracles. Indeed, He showed them some miracles. And the miracle of the Quran, already we talked about it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refused to answer to their demands for miracles. Why so? For a number of reasons. First and foremost, realize that it is not befitting that these demands be met. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is greater and above these people, that when they demand anything, it be given. Also, we know from Sahih Bukhari that once the angel Jibreel came to the Prophet ﷺ and he said, O Muhammad ﷺ, we know that you are grieved by what your people say and do. And we know that you want to show them these miracles. If you want, we can convert the entire mountain of Safa into gold. We will convert it all into gold. But if that happens and they don't believe, they will be punished. In other words, it is the sunnah of Allah that when people reject a miracle, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not just give a miracle for no reason. If the people reject the miracle, it is befitting the dignity and majesty of Allah that these people not be allowed to live, that they be destroyed. The arrogance and insolence of rejecting the miracle of Allah is more than to allow them to live. So Jibreel said, if I do this, they will be destroyed if they don't believe. Or if you want, you can continue preaching and they will be allowed to live. So the Prophet ﷺ became scared that if they don't accept the message of Islam, they will be destroyed. He said, rather, let them be and I will continue preaching. And indeed, eventually, all of them embraced Islam. When the Prophet ﷺ reconquered Mecca, 20 years down the line, many years later, eventually they all accepted Islam. If that miracle had happened and they had rejected it, they would have all been destroyed. So as a mercy for them, the Prophet ﷺ delayed that until the conquest of Mecca. Another tactic that they used is that they attempted to bribe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, negotiate with him. So once they came to him and they said, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, why don't we swap religions? One day we'll be Muslim and one day you follow our religion. A'udhu billah, become a kafir. One day we'll be Muslim and one day you all worship the idols together. At this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ وَلَا أَنَا عَابِدٌ مَا عَبَدْتُمْ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينِ. Oh, you people who have disbelieved, لا أعبد ما تعبدون, I will never worship what you are worshipping. I cannot worship an idol. I cannot bow my head down to a rock or a stone. I know Allah created me. God created me, not this idol. I will never worship. لا أعبد. I will never worship what you are worshipping. Not for one day. Never do it. And neither will you worship what I am worshipping. You have rejected the worship of God, the worship of Allah. You are worshipping idols. I will never worship what you are worshipping. You have your religion, I have my religion. You can't combine between the two religions. You can't be a Muslim one day and an idol worshiper the other day. It doesn't work that way. So that was rejected. They also tried to bribe him. And they said, they sent a delegation to him. And they said, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, choose whatever type of money you want, gold, silver. Choose the type of fabric and clothes you want and we will give it to you. Choose any woman you want in the entire Arabian Peninsula and we will make sure that you get married to her. Do whatever you want, demand it of us and we will do it for you. We have one request, that you stop teaching the message of Islam. We will even make you our king. And they didn't have kings, but they said, we will make you the king of the Quraysh. You will become our ruler, but just one condition, stop teaching Islam. This new religion, worshipping Allah alone, stop it. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam refused their bribes. And he said, I can never do this. He refused their bribes and he continued to preach Islam. They were trying to negotiate with him. All such negotiations will become false. And of course, when all else failed, they had nothing left to do except outright torture and persecution. When all other tactics failed, when all other avenues were closed, the only thing that these cowards could do was to take out their anger and take out their frustration amongst the Muslims. But it was a tribal society and they could not take their anger out upon the noblemen, Abu Bakr and Uthman and even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? Because if they were to harm Abu Bakr and these noblemen, the tribes of Abu Bakr, the tribes of Uthman, the tribe of Banu Hashim would retaliate. Even if Banu Hashim is a pagan tribe, the Prophet ﷺ is a member of Banu Hashim. If one member of Banu Hashim is harmed, the Banu Hashim have to retaliate. That is tribal society for you. It's a gang type of mentality. Doesn't matter who's right and wrong. Doesn't matter if I disagree with the religion of Muhammad ﷺ. He is Banu Hashim. Banu Hashim must protect him. So who did they take their anger out on? They took their anger out upon the weak slaves, the non-Qurayshis, the non-Meccan citizens. Those people who were living in Mecca, but were not of the Meccan society. They were not of the Quraysh. The slaves like Bilal ibn Abi Rabah. The slaves like Yasir and his wife Sumayya. The slaves like Ammar, the son of Yasir. The slaves like Ibn Mas'ud and all of these people who did not have the status, did not have the lineage and blood that the Quraysh had. And inshallah ta'ala, in our next episode, we will talk about some of the physical torture that these early Muslim converts endured, all for the sake of this religion of Islam. I hope to see you next time. Until then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.